Hi, everyone. My name is John Jarcho. I'm a deputy editor at the New England Journal of Medicine and a cardiologist. I'm delighted to be here today on the floor of the ACC to tell you a little bit about some of the things that are going on at the meeting and also to tell you about the Momentum 3 trial that we just published online on our website this morning. Yesterday, in the opening showcase session of the meeting, there were a couple of very interesting randomized trials that were presented. The first was the Odyssey Outcomes trial, which is a randomized trial of the PCSK9 inhibitor alirocumab compared to placebo in patients with a recent acute coronary syndrome. The trial enrolled almost 19,000 patients, and nearly all of the patients were receiving high doses of statin therapy, despite which they continued to have an elevated level of LDL cholesterol. At a median follow-up of 2.8 years, the LDL cholesterol level had dropped to 53 milligrams per deciliter on average in the alirocumab group and 101 milligrams per deciliter on average in the control group. There was also a significant reduction in the primary outcome measure of coronary heart disease death, myocardial infarction, stroke, or unstable angina requiring revascularization. Last year, the New England Journal published the Fourier trial, which is another randomized trial of a different PCSK9 inhibitor, evolocumab, in patients with stable coronary disease. That trial also showed a benefit of PCSK9 inhibition on top of statin therapy. Therefore, the Odyssey Outcomes trial suggests that the benefit previously shown of the PCSK9 inhibitor class on patients with stable coronary disease can also be extended to patients who've had a recent acute coronary syndrome. The second trial that was presented in the opening showcase was called the VEST trial. The VEST trial was a trial of a wearable defibrillator vest versus standard care in patients with an acute myocardial infarction and an ejection fraction of 35% or less. People who have followed this field for a while will know that back in 2002, the MADIT2 trial demonstrated that in patients with a previous myocardial infarction and a reduced ejection fraction, an implantable cardioverter defibrillator, or ICD, actually reduces mortality over the long term. This observation was the basis for the current practice of implanting defibrillators in most patients who have had a myocardial infarction and have a reduced ejection fraction. However, a few years after the MADIT2 trial, a couple of subsequent trials produced surprising results, those being the DYNAMITE and IRIS trials. Those trials showed, surprisingly, that for patients within the first month after an acute myocardial infarction, an implantable cardioverter defibrillator did not produce a benefit on all-cause mortality. This result has been a subject of debate ever since the observation was made, and it has led to guidelines recommendations that defibrillators should not be implanted in patients until after the first month following an acute myocardial infarction. This has then posed the problem for clinicians: how do we manage these patients in their first month after an MI, since they are presumably at high risk of ventricular arrhythmic death, but apparently do not benefit from an ICD? For some clinicians, the solution to this problem has been to recommend the wearable defibrillator vest as a means of protecting the patient against arrhythmic death during that first month. The VEST trial examined this hypothesis by randomizing a group of patients with acute myocardial infarction and an ejection fraction of 35% or less to either the wearable defibrillator vest or to standard care. Disappointingly, the finding that was made for the primary endpoint in this trial was that the defibrillator vest did not reduce the risk of sudden cardiac death or ventricular arrhythmic death in this population of patients. There was what appeared to be a nominal benefit of the wearable defibrillator vest on a secondary outcome, that being all-cause mortality. However, the p-value for benefit on this secondary outcome was 0.04, not corrected for multiple testing, which means that there is uncertainty about whether the wearable defibrillator vest actually does benefit patients with respect to all-cause mortality in this setting. There's also the question, which remains unanswered, of how a device that should only have an impact on arrhythmic death could reduce all-cause mortality, but not sudden cardiac death. I'd also like to talk a little bit about the Momentum 3 trial, which was presented in a late-breaking clinical trials session this morning. Momentum 3 was a randomized comparison of two left ventricular assist devices, the HeartMate 2 device, which is an axial flow pump, and the HeartMate 3 device, which is a centrifugal flow pump. The HeartMate 3 is the newer of the two devices, and it was developed specifically to try to overcome a particular problem with the HeartMate 2 device, which is a propensity for that device to develop ventricular assist device thrombosis, that is, thrombosis within the pump, leading to pump malfunction and the need to remove it surgically and replace it. In the Momentum 3 trial, there was a significant benefit of the HeartMate 3 when compared to the HeartMate 2 on the primary outcome, which was survival free from either disabling stroke or the need for a second operation to replace or remove the pump. The benefit was entirely due to a reduction in reoperations, and because those reoperations are typically due to pump thrombosis, the trial did in fact demonstrate the hoped for benefit of the HeartMate 3, which is a reduction in LVAD thrombosis. This device represents a new paradigm in the field of mechanical cardiac support. For people who are interested in reading the full results of the HeartMate 3 trial, the article is now available online at the New England Journal of Medicine website. Or if you're here at the meeting, you can come by the NEJM booth and pick up a print copy of the Momentum 3 trial at booth number 1344. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to tell you a little bit about what's been going on at the ACC, and I'd like to remind you to stay tuned because there will be some additional simultaneous publication of late-breaking clinical trials coming during the rest of the meeting. Thank you very much.